your Bibles to the book of Daniel. We have gone through the first five chapters of the historical part of this book, and we are starting on chapter 6. And these stories are very, very familiar. And it's very easy to, you know, just not take the story that seriously, because we've heard them since we were little kids. We've heard them often. But it's more than just a fairy tale. Once we get into it, reading it right out of the Bible, we can see what has really gone on. Israel was taken into captivity. They were being punished because they were in apostasy. And through the prophets, God told his people to submit to Babylon. And while you're there, pray for the leadership, pray for your community, and things will go well for you. Go there, build houses, plant gardens, get your kids married. Do all these things while you're there, because it's going to be a period of time. Well, it's going to be 70 years that they have to be there. That's a long time. Well, Nebuchadnezzar was God's servant to bring his judgment against Judah. He didn't completely destroy Judah and Jerusalem and the temple the first time he came by, because his father, who had really established the Babylonian kingdom as being a world powerhouse, died. And so he heard about it, and as quick as he could, which basically it only took he and his men about a month to get from Jerusalem back to Babylon, he became king. So he didn't do all the damage he was going to do. He didn't take everything that he wanted to take. He went through and took everything that he could grab, which was all the temple treasures. Obviously, a lot of people were killed, but he took the best of their stuff and the best of their people. And as we know from Daniel 1, he took the best of the young men and he made them eunuchs to serve him. Now, we don't understand that in our day and age. There is slavery because the Muslims have always put people into slavery. So there is slavery to this day. But it's not like it was when a country comes and takes another country. When they take people captive, they take them to be their slaves. Well, these young men were going to be trained. They found the smartest, the brightest, the most handsome men, and they emasculated them so that they would be a slave dedicated to them for life. And through these chapters, we keep seeing this accusation against either Daniel or his three friends as the captives from Judah. Which means there is something about them, just by glancing at them, that you know that they are a captive from Judah. That never changed. It wasn't because they were emasculated, but they were looking different. Maybe they had chains on. We don't think about that, because we see them as, oh, they did good and God blessed them and they were in charge of the kingdom. But that didn't mean that they still weren't owned by Babylon. They probably had chains, bonds and chains on. They had to do every command that the king gave them. It's not like they had any autonomy. But God had blessed them with fine minds. But they blessed God with their bodies and refused to eat the king's food, anything that would be sin before God. But it wasn't just these four men. There was others that we know from chapter 1. The others didn't have a problem eating food that would have been defiled. But only Daniel and his three friends. That was the only ones. They blessed God and God blessed them. It wasn't good for them. It wasn't happy for them. It wasn't pleasant for them. But they served God as they served their emperor. Then Nebuchadnezzar has a vision. Nobody can figure it out. Everybody who is part of this group of men, all the wise men, astrologers and Chaldeans and soothsayers, they're all going to be killed because nobody knows Nebuchadnezzar's dream. Well, God had blessed Daniel in this area. It's not something that you can figure out with your brain. It's a spiritual gift from God that he was able to understand dreams. And so he told the head executioner, go tell Nebuchadnezzar we've got his interpretation for his dream. Did he have it with him? No, he prayed and he had his three friends pray. And he stood before the king. God gave him the dream and the interpretation. And Nebuchadnezzar was the head of gold, followed by the chest and arms of silver, followed by the belly and the thighs of bronze, followed by the two iron legs, followed by the feet and toes of iron and clay. And Nebuchadnezzar was that golden head. The next chapter we've got Nebuchadnezzar with a big head. And he builds this huge statue, 90 feet tall and 9 feet wide, or 70 feet tall, whatever, 70 cubits, which is about 90 feet, whatever, 70 by 7, whatever. It's just a really tall obelisk of a image, all gold. And it's not unusual for them to have that much gold because, as we know from historians, a lot of Babylon was gold-plated, so it would have shone. It would have been beautiful, and they had plants everywhere. I mean, it would have been just an amazing, beautiful place. So then he made this thing, and then whenever the musicians played, everybody had to bow down and worship the image. Except Daniel's three friends, who were in charge of Babylon, refused to do that. And whoever didn't do it was going to get thrown in a fiery furnace. Well, they smelted a lot of gold. They had plenty of fiery furnaces, and that's something that historians have said, yeah, there are a lot of people were executed by getting thrown into a place like that. And so Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego got thrown in. But God didn't allow them to die. He sent his angel. And Nebuchadnezzar looked in, and he said, there's three men we threw in there, but one of them is walking around who isn't them, and it looks like a son of the gods. But they were walking around. They weren't bound anymore. So the only thing that was burned off would have been what was binding them. So he was afraid and he said, get them out of there. So they pulled them out. And so now there was a decree that you could now worship the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So they had some religious freedom being a Jew, doing things God's way. It was God's plan the entire time to protect his people there. He had that promise. Jeremiah 29. All kinds of promises God gave to them. And those who were faithful, God blessed. But God was going to keep his promise to his people. Well, Nebuchadnezzar got prouder. Still full of himself. And he had a dream. Called in Daniel. There's this dream that really bothered me. Big tree. Huge. Took care of everything on the planet. All the fruit, all the animals lived underneath it, all the birds lived in it. And it got cut down. And it was bound with this iron bond, brass bond. And there was Daniel, the interpreter of dreams. I wish this dream was for one of your enemies. Well, he was going to be cut down. And Daniel said to Nebuchadnezzar, you know, if you just do what you know to do, which is right, which is have justice and extend mercy and compassion, and don't do the things you know that are wrong, maybe this won't have to happen. But 12 months later, Nebuchadnezzar was walking around in this beautiful place, one of the seven wonders of the ancient world, and says, look at this Babylon, this place that I've made for myself, for my glory. And he was struck, and he was turned into basically an animal's brain was given to him. He was no longer thinking lucidly, and he was acting like an animal. And in other words, they would have had to chain him up somewhere to keep him from hurting himself or anybody else, and he was there where the wild asses were, eating grass outside all day and all night. The dew that came from the sky would cover him, and his hair was all matted looking like eagle feathers, and his fingernails turned into something that looked like claws. And that happened for 7 years, exactly like the dream said. And he came back to his senses, and he gave praise to God. God wanted him saved. God didn't want him to just have a mental assent that the God of the Jews was the true God. It had to be Nebuchadnezzar's God. And that's what he did. He was being taken care of, and his kingdom was being taken care of by Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They were answerable to God for what they did. They did things the right way. And when he came back to his senses, even all the other nobles came back under his authority. Nobody took nothing. The place had blossomed with him being gone. Well, Nebuchadnezzar at some point died. And in the period when that happened, there was a few years there where a son took over and a son-in-law took over, and then there was murder and intrigue. All kinds of stuff happened. Until finally, Belshazzar was the king of Babylon. But as we know from history, he was just the king of Babylon itself, but not the king of the entire empire. It was Nabonidus, his father, who was in charge of all that, which the Bible is in perfect alignment with. History always seems to catch up with the Bible. Well, Belshazzar would have been about 14 years old when his grandfather, Nebuchadnezzar, went crazy and was brought back to his senses. He knew about this. But he was being brought up in Babylon. He wasn't being brought up in a nice God-fearing home. He was brought up to love everything that would give you pleasure. He was brought up being a prince. He had the best of everything. He was a spoiled brat, just like everybody else who grows up in an opulent home. You can't tell him anything, much less having to fear the God of the Jews. And he became king of Babylon. Well, we know from history what was going on. Babylon was no longer a strong empire. There was another empire that was getting stronger during this period of time. And that was the Medes and the Persians. We know from history that Nabonidus had escaped Babylon. But during this period of time, when Belshazzar was there and having a big party for 1,000 nobles, why would there be 1,000 nobles there? Because Babylon was this impregnable fortress. And all of their little city-states had already been wiped out by the Medes and Persians. They were there seeking refuge. Nabonidus had ran away to see if he couldn't save himself. He was actually living in a different city that he had founded, but that city was taken by the Medes and the Persians. So it ended up that Nabonidus was taken captive, and so as we know from history, it's not in the book of Daniel, but we don't know much about him because he wasn't in this part of the story. The part of the story that was important was the fact that Belshazzar was partying with all the nobles. See, you can relax. You can trust this fortress. You can trust our prosperity. You can trust all the things that you see. You can trust the gold that's plated these walls. Let's party. And it was a party. It was a drunken orgy. the ugly thing, but this is Babylon. This is what the world does. Whatever could give you pleasure, you do it to the point of making yourself sick. That's what the world does. That's what's going on. And in his own personal pride, self-confidence, and confidence in the building that they were in, he was obviously making fun of the prophecy that the Medes and Persians were going to take over the kingdom. So he made fun of the God who gave that prophecy. I'll just take all of his bowls and all of his goblets, and we're going to get drunk using them. We're going to eat off of them. We took them. They're ours. As they were partying, using the things that were holy unto the Lord, fingers of a hand showed up and started writing on the wall, "Many, many, Tikal Upharsin." That changed the party. He might have been drunk before, but I'm sure he got cold, dead sober that moment. His knees were knocking and his hips were loosed. The party was over. And they called in all the wise men. Nobody could figure it out. The party has stopped. There's no more music. There's no more dancing. There's no more carousing. There's no more drinking. All they could do is stare at the wall. When the Queen Mother heard about it, she comes in. She hadn't been at the party. She was probably the widow of Nebuchadnezzar. She comes in and says, "There is a man during Nebuchadnezzar's reign, your father, who can interpret these things." So they bring in Daniel. Daniel looks at it. They say, "Oh, if you know the interpretation, you know, it will give you this really pretty clothes to wear and a gold chain, and you'll be third in the kingdom." Well, we know he'd be third in the kingdom because Belshazzar is second in the kingdom. His father is first in the kingdom. He says, so Daniel says, "I don't want your stuff. I don't want the position. Keep it for yourself." And he says, "You knew how God humbled your father Nebuchadnezzar." Well, it's actually his grandfather, but that's the word they use. "You knew this. And you didn't humble yourself." He preached to him. He preached hard. I'm sure that the Queen Mother would have known the holiness of the God of the Jews, because she would have seen the experience of her husband Nebuchadnezzar go through this and see Nebuchadnezzar get saved and his life was changed. She could see the integrity of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego ruling the kingdom. She could see all these things. She wasn't there at the party. I'm sure she was fed up with the party atmosphere of the new administration. Daniel, I'm sure, wasn't happy to go to that party either, because his influence was changing Babylon to the good. When you came into Daniel's presence, all of a sudden you're there with the standard by which you must meet. And it's a bar so high you'll never jump over it. This is a godly man. This is more than just a statesman. This is more than just somebody who is some kind of, you know, holy man guru with the, you know, with the robe and, you know, saying funny things. No, this is somebody who, you stand before him, you know, you stand before a holy God. And I'm sure Daniel was fed up with what had happened to the culture since Belshazzar took over. And he preaches. He preaches hard. And then he says, "Many, many." Well, as soon as you got a word in there twice, that means it's for sure, absolutely, and it's happening quickly. "Many" means God hath numbered thy kingdom and finished it. It's counted up. It's already been counted and finished it. "Tekel, thou art weighed in the balances and found wanting." You've already been weighed, and you don't measure up. You haven't met God's expectations. "And Perez, which is the singular form without the "and" added to it of Upharsin. Thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and Persians. Well, then they're going to make, you know, Daniel feel good, and here's the great, you got the interpretation, you got the position, you got all this. Well, they just put Daniel in the position that he had been in under Nebuchadnezzar. It's not something that he was looking forward to. It was just another title that somebody gives you. It's not worth anything. It's only worth something in the world's view. Verse 30 of chapter 5, in that night was Belshazzar, the king of Chaldeans, slain. And we know from history what happened. Cyrus's forces had redirected the Euphrates River. They poured tons and tons of dirt on the Euphrates River and redirected it. So it no longer ran underneath the city of Babylon. And as soon as it was down to waist deep, Cyrus's men marched underneath the city. They climbed up the walls. They got in. They had a special detachment that was sent directly to Belshazzar's throne and took him out first. Killed everybody in the party. I mean, the idea that they were having a festival and a this thing is in a historical account. They have this thing called the Nabonidus Chronicle, and he's got there's all kinds of stuff on Cyrus. I mean, there's lots of historians, a lot of history that was recorded for us. And it all lines up with the biblical account. These things are like, it's clay, and it's called cuneiform, and they put this little stylus, and they put all this stuff in the clay. So here's all the history written down, and then it's fired. So it's permanent. And sure enough, they found this thing. They keep finding stuff. History keeps, you know, catching up with what the Bible has already said. Well, they killed Belshazzar. They killed all the nobles. And Babylon is now in the hands of the Medes and Persians. Verse 31, and Darius the Median took the kingdom, being about 62 years old. So now we meet a man who is now in charge of Babylon, and he's 62. And his name is called Darius the Mede. Darius the Mede is a problem. And all the critics of the Bible love problems. It's only a problem because this name that we have in the Bible, they don't see that name in other historical accounts. But it's not a problem, because the name Darius means the one who holds the scepter. And later, though, there's going to be Darius the First, and there's going to be a Darius the Second. I mean, Darius means the one who holds the scepter. So it's not a problem. It's not a man's name. It's the position. But the problem comes with Darius the Mede, as opposed to Darius the Persian. But he's the one in charge. So we've got to know who this Darius guy is. So I just kind of leave that hanging here for a little bit, and I'm going to read chapter 6 of Daniel. And it pleased Darius to set over the kingdom 120 princes, which should be over the whole kingdom. And over these three presidents of whom, Daniel was first, that the princes might give account unto them, and the king should have no damage. Then this Daniel was preferred above the presidents and princes, because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king sought to set him over the whole realm. Then the presidents and the princes sought to find occasion against Daniel concerning the kingdom, but they could find no occasion nor fault, forasmuch as he was faithful. Neither was there any error or fault found in him. Then said these men, we shall not find any occasion against this Daniel, except we find it against him concerning the law of his God. Then these presidents and princes assembled together to the king and said thus to him, King Darius, live forever. All the presidents of the kingdom and the governors and the princes, the counselors and the captains have counseled together to establish a royal statute to make a firm decree that whosoever shall ask a petition of any god or man for 30 days, save thee, O king, he shall be cast into the den of lions. Now, O king, establish the decree and sign the writing that it be not changed according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which altereth not. Wherefore, King Darius signed the writing and decree. Now, when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being opened in his chamber towards Jerusalem, he kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day and praised and gave thanks before his God, as he did aforetime. Then these men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplication before his God. Then they came near and spake before the king concerning the king's decree, Hast thou not signed a decree that every man shall ask a petition of any god or man within 30 days save of thee, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions? The king answered and said, The thing is true, according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which altereth not. Then answered they and said before the king, That Daniel, which is of the children of the captivity of Judah, regardeth not thee, O king, nor the decree that thou hast signed, but maketh his petition 3 times a day. Then the king, when he heard these things, was sore displeased with himself, and set his heart on Daniel to deliver him. And he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver him. Then these men assembled unto the king and said unto the king, Know, O king, that the law of the Medes and the Persians is, that no decree nor statute which the king established may be changed. Then the king commanded, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. Now the king spake and said unto Daniel, Thy God, whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee. And a stone was brought and laid upon the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet and with the signet of his lords, that the purpose might not be changed concerning Daniel. Then the king went to his palace and passed the night fasting, neither were instruments of music brought before him, and his sleep went from him. Then the king arose very early in the morning and went in haste to the den of lions. And when he came to the den, he cried with a lamentable voice unto Daniel. And the king spake and said to Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the living God, is thy God, whom thou servest continually, able to deliver thee from the lions? Then said Daniel unto the king, O king, live forever. My God hath sent his angels and hath shut the lions' mouths, that they have not hurt me, forasmuch as before him innocency was found in me, and also before thee, O king, have I done no harm. Then was the king exceedingly glad for him, and commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no manner of hurt was found upon him, because he believed in his God. And the king commanded, and they brought those men which had accused Daniel, and they cast them into the den of lions, them, their children, their wives, and the lions had the mastery over them, and break all their bones in pieces, or ever they came at the bottom of the den. Then King Darius wrote unto all the people, nations, and languages that dwell in all the earth, Peace be multiplied unto you. I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom men tremble and fear before the God of Daniel, for he is the living God and steadfast forever, and his kingdom which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall be even unto the end. He delivereth and rescueth, and he worketh signs and wonders in heaven and in earth. Who hath delivered Daniel from the power of the lions? So this Daniel prospered in the reign of Darius and in the reign of Cyrus the Persian. Dear Father, in Jesus' name, we ask that you give us understanding into your word. And Lord, let your word change us, dear God. We thank you for this story that we've heard since we were kids. Lord, let us have true insight in what's really going on here and help us see things your way, dear God. And love you with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. and serve you only. In Jesus' name, amen. It's a great story. And it's a story that you have since you were a kid. And you see the little pictures and all the little plays and the cartoons and all that. And most of the time, you see Daniel as a young man. Or even as a boy. Because they're cutifying it. They're cutesying up the Bible. And they got the big doughy eyes, you know, and the precious moments, dolls and all that. Do you know when this happened? Nebuchadnezzar took Jerusalem. He didn't destroy it, but he took the stuff and he took the people. That's when Daniel was taken captive. Nebuchadnezzar showed up two more times and finally destroyed Jerusalem and the temple and everything else. But Daniel worked for Nebuchadnezzar for years, till Nebuchadnezzar finally died of old age. And then there was this period of time, a few years, where there was intrigue and murder and all that. And finally, you've got Nabonidus in charge, and then he puts his son Belshazzar as the king of Babylon. And that goes on for a few years. And the party clown finally gets what's coming to him by God. And Darius, or Darius, however you want to say it, gets put in charge of Babylon. Well, as I said before, who is this Darius? We know from this Nabonidus Chronicle that Babylon was conquered by a man called Ugbaru. Ugbaru was the general who was in charge of taking out Babylon. And he was the governor of Gutium, which is a different city. He led Cyrus's army and entered the city of Babylon on the night of Belshazzar's feast. Nabonidus, who was Belshazzar's father, had fled Babylon the day before only to be captured and later die in exile. When Babylon fell to Ugbaru on October 11th, 539 BC, Cyrus himself remained with the other troops at Opis, and not until 18 days later, October 29th, 539 BC, did he actually arrive in Babylon. A man by the name of Gubaru was appointed by Cyrus to rule in Babylon. Gubaru was born in 601 BC, and we know that the time of the fall of Babylon to the Persians was 539 BC, which would make Gubaru 62 years old. The title Darius simply means the one who holds the scepter. King Cyrus set up Gubaru to rule over the province of Babylon under the title Darius. So that's Gubaru is Daniel. Gubaru is Darius the Mede. Gubaru is a Mede. It seems really simple, and we know that he was 62. I mean, it's really clear. But before they had totally understood this Gubaru person, they tried to figure out, well, maybe it's Ugbaru, the general who took out Babylon, except Ugbaru didn't live that much longer after he destroyed Babylon. So he couldn't have been the ruler. But here's Gubaru, who definitely was put in charge and he was 62. It's pretty clear who Darius the Mede is from the historical account. But others say that Cyrus, since he was half Persian and half Median, would have been called, because the one who holds the scepter is called Darius. He was Darius. Except later we see Cyrus and he's called Cyrus. So it doesn't necessarily, it doesn't make as much sense, but there is a lot of the commentators you read, they're convinced, I mean, these are good guys, but they're convinced that Cyrus is Darius. He just happens to be called Darius in these two chapters, of chapter 5 and chapter 6. I don't think it's a very good explanation, but I just have to tell you that. And there's another view that equates Darius the Mede with Cambyses, who is Cyrus's son, who ruled Persia from about 530 to 522 BC. So we've got a lot of views, and these come from good commentators. But the problem is that we don't have Gubaro's name there. It doesn't make any difference. We know how old he was, so we can figure out which historical character he happened to be. So I don't have any problem with the fact that Gubaro is Darius the Mede. There is a man who named Whitcomb. You know, Whitcomb and Morris did the Genesis Flood, and he's a very conservative commentator, and he wrote a book called Darius the Mede, and he makes his explanation really clear in there, and he also in his commentary it's also very clear. So I just want to tell you, if you're reading commentaries on Daniel, most of the old ones don't believe that there is that the book of Daniel is pure. They think there's errors in it. Because they don't believe that that God's word is inspired. So they don't take the Bible that seriously. But God's word is inspired. And as they unearth things about history, you can see how it, you know, history finally catches up with what the Bible already said. So I'm just saying that because if you start studying deeper in some of the stuff, you're going to see really good conservative guys who are sincerely wrong in this area. Okay, so I just want to say that. So I'm sure that it was this Gubaro character, just because of his age. And he didn't stay in charge that long. He didn't live that much longer. But I just wanted to bring up the fact that Gubaru, being 62 years old, is still younger than Daniel. Daniel is probably 85 years old right now. I just have to say that. You have to know he's not the little kid with the precious moment's eyes. This is an old man. An old man who's 85 could fall and break a hip, okay? They threw him into... It must have been the lions that broke his fall. This is an old man. And this old man has seen a faithful God his entire life. From the time that he was brought to Babylon, he already prepared in his heart not to defile himself. There was a preparation of his heart. He didn't care if it meant that he would die. He wanted to give God the glory with what was left of his body and his mind and his heart. And he did. God showed himself strong on his behalf. And in the process, what happened? Politically, during the reign of the Babylonians, Judaism was a legal religion. They had religious freedom to worship their God. Now, they couldn't go down to the temple and do a sacrifice because there wasn't any temple. Everything was gone. Judaism has changed, but they were following God in a foreign place to the best of their ability. And they were allowed to. Because there were three men who were willing to put their life on the line and disobey the king's orders and worship only Yahweh Jehovah God, the one true God, Most High God. They got thrown in the fiery furnace. And it was probably Jesus himself who showed up with them, untied their hands, and was having a nice conversation in that fiery furnace. And they were called out, and there was only three men who came out. And Nebuchadnezzar now had a fear of the Lord, because no other God that he's ever come into contact with could ever do this. Because no other God was real. There's only a one true God. Everything else is wood and stone and silver and gold. All dead. No, there's one living God. And God cared for Nebuchadnezzar's soul, so God cut him short. God broke his pride. God brought him to himself when he came to a place of humiliation. He could see that there was only one true God, the living God. Well, the next administration was completely pagan, just like it was when Daniel first got there. And God showed up strong on behalf of his people. And Daniel preached to that sinner, and he didn't repent. It was too late. It was written on the wall. It was too late. No more time to repent. I mean, he could have been there on his knees. He could have been weeping. Oh, yeah, I've been a bad boy. Oh, yeah, you got to help me. There wasn't any of that. He kept his pride to the very end, and he was killed that night, exactly the way God said. Sometimes there is a line, and you've had enough truth to rebel against, and it's over. That's what happened. So now the Medes and the Persians are in charge, exactly as God said. Well, it's a completely different country, a completely different administration. Now, everything that you thought were your rights as a Jew to be able to worship according to what God has planned, God's way, taking God's word seriously, doing things His way, now all that is up in the air. Because the Medes and the Persians are now in charge. Now what's going to happen? God had to show Himself strong again and prove that He is the one true God before this new administration, this new country. What's interesting is, it starts off right away, it pleased Darius to set over the kingdom 120 princes, and then three presidents over the top of them. Now, the 120, the actual word that we could have is called a satrap. And then over them were like three overlords, so to speak, of these satraps. Now, a satrap is basically, he has all the authority of a king in his own right. Absolute authority with what has been put in his hands to manage. All those people, whatever that town is, whatever that city is. He has complete authority. But there is 120 of these with complete authority. And there are three above them. So they still have to answer to these three. And these three have to answer to Darius. Well, actually, it's going to be Cyrus. Because we know that Gubaru was put in charge of Babylon. Now, what we don't know for sure is these 120 satraps, was it just the realm of Babylon? Or if it was the entire realm of the complete Medo-Persian Empire? Because the Medo-Persian Empire, at this point, once they took Babylon, is now bigger than the Babylonian Empire. If you remember from Nebuchadnezzar's dream, Babylon is what? The head of gold. Followed by what? Silver. Chest and arms of silver, Medes and Persians. It's silver. It is not as precious as gold is. And that has a lot to do with the administration. Nebuchadnezzar was a despot. Only him. He made all the rules. He could do whatever he wanted. He could change his mind. He could do whatever he wanted all the time. He could put anybody in position or take them down. He could kill somebody or keep them alive. He could do whatever he wanted to do all the time. It all went to him. The Medes and the Persians had a completely different governmental system. You had a whole bunch of people. And as we read this, it talks about the presidents and the princes. Well, you could say prime ministers and presidents, or prime minister. I mean, we don't have it in our day and age. But you got a conglomerate of people, of leaders, who make the decisions. It is no longer just a king. So in other words, Cyrus is in charge of the Medo-Persian Empire right now. But he isn't the authority that Nebuchadnezzar was. He had to have agreement with the other satraps. So it's a whole different government. And so you see that coming out as we read the story. Because now they're talking about this thing that is a royal statute, a firm decree. And it's according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which altereth not. Now, we never saw this in the Babylonian Empire, because you got one emperor, and he's in charge of everything. If you want something changed, you go talk to him. Now you've got this whole other thing, which is not just one person. One person can't change the law anymore. Now you have to have an agreement of this group of people. So it's not the one authority head of gold, it's silver. It's totally different. And once they've made a decision, it is unalterable. Which is a safety feature of their government. So now you have like what we have, like a constitution, a rule of law. Once it's agreed upon, that's it, it can't be changed. Now the only way you can change a law is to by getting another law that supersedes it. But you can't change it once it's done. All you can do is get something that supersedes it that makes the other one really of no value anymore, even though it's going to stay in place. So you have to understand that's the government that's now taken over. Darius wants to put Daniel in charge. Daniel's 85 years old. He is already trusting Daniel. How long has he talked to Daniel? A few minutes? A couple of days? A couple of weeks? We don't know exactly when it happened, but he was setting up this kingdom pretty rapidly after taking control. But he has in his mind to do that. Because he trusted Daniel that he was not going to have any losses. Which means from the short amount of time that he's known Daniel, he knows that he is a man of integrity. He's a trustworthy man. Quite interesting. Well, he obviously would have known from everybody else he would have talked to, because you're pulling together a government, plus you're pulling together the people who are there. Now, when the Medes and the Persians took out Babylon, they didn't just destroy everything. They didn't do it like the Babylonians did. They tried to keep everything intact and keep it all good. We know from a historical account that the people who lived in Babylon didn't even know that it wasn't Babylonian anymore. All of a sudden they came to realize the Medes and the Persians are in charge. Because it happened so rapidly, they didn't have any idea. All of a sudden, they're now going to be taxed. Because they're now working for the Medes and the Persians. What's interesting about the Medes and the Persians government, they didn't do what Babylon did, they didn't do what Assyria did. You know, they would show up and destroy everything and take anything of value, and it left nothing. That's not what happened. The Medes and the Persians, they were a little bit more smarter. They want the money. You keep people where they live, doing their businesses, and you can take the profits. Let them be fat and happy. Let them make a profit, because that profit's yours. We're talking income tax. We're talking let people be as successful as they possibly can so that we'll take their money. They weren't destroying things unless you were really rebellious against their government. Well, the Medes and the Persians became filthy rich because they weren't just destroying cultures. They were absorbing everything. They were taking everything of value and leaving it there. They weren't just taking it and say, oh, we got all the goodies. They were saying, you could stay there, have a really nice life. As long as you live in peace, we'll allow you to have all the prosperity you want, keep all your stuff, except we get taxed now. That was quite a change in history. Well, the same thing happened in Babylon. So the people who lived there didn't even know anything changed. All of a sudden they realized there's Medes and Persians in charge, and the Babylonian administration isn't there anymore. So this is a whole different government. So when we see Darius wanting to put Daniel in charge, he could see a man he could trust. And here's a man who's already had that administrative position for years. He knows how everybody is. He knows how all the other city-states and other countries all around them have to interact. He already knows all this stuff. Put him in charge. For some reason he could trust him. Well, why could he trust him? Because he wasn't Babylonian. He was a slave working for Babylon. That's why he could be trusted. Pretty amazing. I mean, God set this thing up in just an amazing way. Well, unfortunately, the folks who Darius set up in power didn't want this captive from Judah ruling over them. So they came up with this nice little plan. The only way they could get Daniel, they couldn't catch him in anything. Now if you notice, just like it is today, you know, any conservative, they dig up all of his past, and they try to find out the place where, you know, maybe in college he had a reefer in his mouth. You know, maybe he was a drunk. Maybe he had an illicit affair. Maybe he made some bad choices. And we're going to dig up everything and see if maybe he didn't pay a phone bill or you know, was late on a tax payment or something. But the liberals, all part of the, you know, the elitist coastal few, you know, you can have a lawyer hold on to your stuff and nobody can dig into it. But you, if you're a conservative, you know, they're going to go find something they can get you on. They couldn't get anything on Daniel. Since the time he was probably a teenager, he has been living a devout life to the Lord. Obviously, he purposed in his heart that he wasn't going to sin against his God. He was above reproach. You couldn't get him on anything. It wasn't as though he'd always done a good job at things. It was the fact that that was his practice from the time he was taken captive, to do things the right way, to be a man of integrity his entire life. They couldn't get anything on him. But what did they see? Well, there is a weakness in him because he is completely dedicated to his God. Well, these people have all kinds of gods. And they don't care about anybody worshiping any kind of God, but they are looking at him and watching him and saying, he does the same thing all the time. He is very devoted to his God. We can't get him on anything that normally you could get rid of somebody in charge about, but we can get him on his devotion to his God. So that's what he did. They said, okay, we got it. We'll have everybody basically pray to Darius for a month. So they brought this up to Darius. They said, oh, we all together came up with this great idea. You know, basically we're going to force the whole kingdom to be under your authority and treat you with the respect that you really deserve. You know, we'll just have everybody, just for a month, everybody will just have to pray to you like a god. Just, they can't ask for anything else, can't thank anything, any god or anybody, just you. And this will, in 30 days you can get a good habit. And all these people will then have this good habit of having you in charge, nobody else. We got to do something really, really strong to get people break out of their way of thinking. You know, it's no longer Babylon situation. We got to fix this, you know. So here, this will work. And everybody will get the practice of only coming to you. And he says, they're coming and they say, we all have this agreement. Was Daniel a part of that agreement? Obviously not. And you could ask the question, well, where is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego during this period of time? They might not be living anymore. I mean, Daniel is 85 years old. So they may no longer be alive. I mean, that's a long time. Plus, we don't know what happened to them during the change of administration between Nebuchadnezzar and Nabonidus. I mean, all kinds of intrigue and death and, you know, murder and all kinds of stuff went on during that period of time. So we don't know. We don't have those stories. I mean, they should have been in retirement by this time anyway. Because they would have, if they were alive, they would have been Daniel's age. So verse 8, Now, O king, establish the decree and sign the writing that it be not changed according to the laws and the Medes and the Persians, which altereth not. Therefore, King Darius signed the writing and the decree. Okay, good idea, good decree, here you go. Sign another law. We'll pass the law. Well, now it can't be altered. Now it can't be changed. Verse 10, now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being opened in his chamber towards Jerusalem, he kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, as he did aforetime. Well, what does it mean, as he did aforetime? This was his manner of life. This is what he always did. It wasn't like, okay, well, I'm going to make this political statement because if I don't stand up for it, this is my chance to make sure that Judaism becomes a law in Medes and Persians. And it's not about that. It's not about the greater good. It's about the glory of God. He is going to refuse to disobey God, and in the process, he's going to disobey men. That's what he's going to do. He is going to practice civil disobedience. By doing what? Praying. So, Medes and Persians have a law. Thou shalt not pray in public. What? Ever heard of that before? Can you pray in a public school? Of course not. But I guarantee if there's a final exam, there's going to be prayer in schools. I mean, what are they thinking? They still do a prayer, you know, in Congress. But separation between church and state. No, what the Constitution says, basically the Bill of Rights, and the United States of America is not going to set up its own religion for people to follow. That's what it means. It doesn't mean, oh, you can't have them both together. We also have the right to worship as we please, which means in your business place, even if you work for the government, you can have a Bible on your desk and you can worship, you can pray, you can do whatever you want. If you go to school, you can pray. You can sing a hymn if you want, as long as you're not disrupting the class. But they don't let you hang around if you do stuff like that. But what did Daniel do? He practiced civil disobedience. He disobeyed the government. Doesn't matter if you take prayer out of schools. You pray because Yahweh Jehovah God is your God. You're devoted to Him. You love Him because what He's done for you. We love Him because He first loved us. We serve Him because He gave everything to save us. Our whole life is a response for His grace to us. Is somebody going to tell us not to worship, not to read the Bible? They might. They've done it in plenty of other countries. So what do? You disobey the government. So then God's going to bless you for doing that? No, you might die. You might have your property taken. You might have all your civil rights taken away. You might have your whole family taken away from you, and maybe even killed in front of your face before you are tortured to death. There is consequences for disobeying the government. But there's also a God who is worthy of it. He is absolutely worthy of it. And it doesn't matter what they do to us. Jesus says, don't fear those, and all they can do is kill the body. Fear those instead. Fear the one instead who, after killing you, can throw your soul into hell. Who's that, the devil? No, the devil can't kill you, and the devil can't throw you into hell. He's not the one in charge of hell, forcing people to shovel more coal to make it hot enough for him. No, God is the one who is in charge of our every breath, our every heartbeat. He's the one who can have us killed whenever He wants. He's the one who's made an appointment for us, and we're not going early and we're not going late. He's the one to fear God. That means we got to live our life in slavish fear. Oh no, I don't know if He's going to hit the smite button because I've been a bad boy today. No, we fear, we have respect, we honor, we take him seriously, we take his position seriously, we realize every moment of the day that he is our creator and he's the one to whom we must answer. That's what it means to fear God. If you're living in sin, you better be afraid. If you're doing things you know are wrong, you better be afraid, because if you are his child, he's going to spank you as a good dad should. And if you're not his child, there's a place that's prepared for the devil and his angels and all those who do what the devil wants. And it's called the lake of fire. You have to answer to your creator. Yeah, there is a fear. Absolutely. We're going to be held on account. Absolutely. Well, did Daniel do this because he's afraid of God? He did this because he loved God with all of his heart, mind, soul, and strength. He prepared himself not to defile himself with the king's food when he was a teenager. And now that he is 85 years old and he's seen God be faithful to him every year of his life, you think now he's going to go, oh, well, I don't know if I can trust God? No, if this means his end, that's fine. He's already 85. He's been living in Babylon his whole life. You think he wants to live another day in this horrible pagan palace? You think he loves it there? Oh, but he's in charge. He's had all the gold and people want to put him in charge. He's got all these blessings. Every moment he was there, when he wasn't with his God, he was burdened with the sin that was all around him. With all the ugliness of all the temptations and all the ugly things that this world has to offer that tells you, you better like this or there's something wrong with you. He had to deal with that every single day. You think he loved being there? You think he loved it when Belshazzar was in charge and he was his party animal and everybody was getting drunk and having orgies and stuff? You think he loved it? I think he spent most of his time praying and interceding. And when he was called into that banquet hall and he saw meeny, meeny, tickly, farson, he had a sermon ready to go. That sermon was ready to go for a long time. And now was his opportunity to say what he needed to say, which he never had the opportunity to say. Because there's no way that Belshazzar would ever allow this man to come into his presence. Not a representative from this God of holiness. No, he took the holy things that belong to a holy God and started getting drunk in them. Daniel is not going to, at this point, get scared. He's willing to die. He's probably happy to go to be with his Lord instead of having to deal with another corrupt administration. It would be a just judgment of God for a corrupt administration to take over and fall into, disarray because they have people who lack integrity to be in charge. But here he is, a man of integrity. Here he is. He has his moment. So what does he do? He did as aforetime. He did what he always did. He didn't do it just because now is the time to make my political statement. No, he did what he always did. He did what he did since he was a kid. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house. He closed his windows and called up his friends to say, we can just be closet Christians here for a month. It's okay. We don't have to let anybody know, it's okay. It'll be over. No, his windows being opened in his chamber, where? Towards Jerusalem. He kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God. This is what he did. This was what he always did. This is how he always lived his life. This was, every single day was the same thing. 3 times a day. This was his custom. As was his custom. If you figure that 3 times a day he prayed, and he was 85 years old, he would have by this time made 95,000 prayers. If you want to add it up, just saying. Okay. Psalm 55, starting with verse 16, "As for me, I will call upon God, and the Lord shall save me. Evening and morning and at noon I will pray and cry aloud, and he shall hear my voice." Comes right out of the Psalms. Three times a day. It's what you pray. It's when you pray. So the rest of the time you're on your own? No, what does it tell us in the New Testament? Pray without ceasing. Keep on praying. Live in a constant state of prayer. It means you can't acknowledge people. You can't even look them in the eyes. Because, oh, don't bother me, I'm praying right now. It has nothing to do with separating yourself and being some kind of ascetic, a monk or a brother or a nun or whatever it is. It has nothing to do with that. It has to do with every moment of your life, you are staying in the conscious understanding that you are in the presence of God. And you are living your life as one in the presence of God. Not just being afraid to do what's wrong and working really hard to work as unto the Lord, but living your life knowing that your Father is there, taking care of you, encouraging you, there with help in time of need, there to receive your thanks and gratitude for what He is continuing to do, plus what He's already done for you. You know, we can have boxes. You know, we have the little tubbies with the toys in them on the shelf, you know, and you pull out one tubby, it's got the Weebles and the Weeble toys for them. And you got the other one, and you got the little people toys and the little peoples that are in there. You got the other ones, you got the cars. And you got another one, and you got the stuff for the Duplos and the Duplo guy. Each one of those tubbies, different kind of toy to play with. We can do that. It's not just when you're a kid. It's not just getting organized with your toys. We can have, okay, this is my work life. That's my little cubby right there. Not everything, and the rest is mine. And then, okay, this is when I'm home. Okay, this is my task for when I'm at home. This is all, and then here, okay, here's my church box over here. And then we can live our life that way. I'm on my own unless I got to do stuff for work. I'm on my own until I got to do stuff for the house. I'm on my own unless I just do stuff for church. That's not how Daniel lived his life. That's not what the New Testament tells us how to live our life. When we're a disciple, it means we're with Jesus 24/7, walking with Him, following Him wherever He goes. That's what it means. We're going to do secular stuff. We're going to do mundane stuff. We're going to wash dishes. We're going to wash the floors. We're going to go to work. We're going to do stuff. But it is never separated from us being attached to our God. Three times a day. It was a biblical practice. It was also something that went on during temple worship. There wasn't any temple anymore. But if there had been, this would have been going on in the temple. So you would be joining in with others during that period of time in worshiping God and giving praise and thanks to God. But the window was open, and it was open towards Jerusalem. So, what is that? Well, it's a different direction from where he was, his window being open, than for us. But this is also biblical. In 2 Chronicles 6, this is a time when, you know, Solomon is dedicating the temple, starting in verse 34. There's a lot of it here, but starting in verse 34. "When your people go out to battle against their enemies, whenever you send them, and when they pray to you towards this city which you have chosen and the temple which I have built for your name, then hear from heaven their prayer and their supplication and maintain their cause. When they sin against you, for there is no one who does not sin, and you become angry with them to deliver them to the enemy, and they take them captive to a land far or near, yet when they come to themselves in the land where they are carried captive and repent and make supplication to you in the land of their captivity, saying, 'We have sinned, we have done wrong and committed wickedness,' and when they return to you with all their heart and with all their soul into the land of their captivity where you have carried captive, and pray toward their land which you gave them gave to their fathers the city which you have chosen, and towards the temple which I have built for your name. Then hear from heaven, your dwelling place, their prayer, their supplication, and maintain their cause, and forgive your people who have sinned against you." That was Solomon's prayer as the temple was being dedicated. And Solomon was really clear. They're going to sin, and you're going to take them captive because that's what you said is going to happen. And when they're there, they can look towards Jerusalem. When we partake of the Lord's Supper, Jesus says, "Do this in remembrance of me." When Paul talks about it in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, he says, "Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he returns." We take the Lord's Supper and we are planning ahead for the return of Jesus Christ. We're thinking ahead for the time when Jesus is going to return. We are absolutely remembering him, but we're looking forward to that time. It's the same principle. They are looking to that place. We are looking to the promises of the new covenant when we take communion. When they were looking towards Jerusalem, they are looking to the promises of the Davidic covenant and Messiah to come. That's what they're looking forward to. They have the same messianic hope that we do when we are proclaiming the Lord's death until he returns. We're looking forward to Jesus to come. It's the same thing. So I just have to say that. What Daniel was doing was so amazingly theological and filled with devotion. I mean, he was there long enough that his room was able to have a window that faced Jerusalem. I mean, I don't know exactly. I didn't figure out the angles and all that, where it would have been from Babylon to Jerusalem. But praise God. He had an open window. I mean, God can't hear you, the window closed? No, he's got an open window. Why? Because his testimony is as important to unbelievers as it is to believers. Us praying three times a day, so to speak, that means you're going out for lunch and you bow your head and you give thanks to the Creator of the universe who provided this food to you. Oh, but I worked hard for this. Oh, it's only a Big Mac, and it was a couple of bucks. No, it is food from the hands of your Creator. Of course, if you're at McDonald's, you better pray, but that's beside the point. No, it's giving thanks to the one who gives us all things. And if it's done in public, praise God. Because the unbelievers need to see you are devoted to your God and you take your God seriously. The believers need to be encouraged that there's somebody else there who is devoted to their God and willing to take it out into the public. A faith that is secret is only of value to you. It's pretty selfish. Now, I understand during periods of persecution, it's very difficult to have a public faith. I had worked for a Moscow bakery when I was in the seminary for a few months, and I had kind of asked them about it because the Iron Curtain was still in place at the time, and here they were from Moscow, and they had all these aspirations of having a real good bakery doing really nice high-end baked goods, and they ended up making all their money from, you know, breakfast, you know, donuts and, you know, pastries and all that. That's how they stayed in business. And little by little they were getting contracts of, you know, decent baked goods. But all that to say, I had talked to Mila, who was, you know, it was Mark and Mila's bakery, and she said, "We believe but in our heart." And she'd been there long enough to know English, but she was not... She because she grew up there her whole life in Moscow, she didn't feel any kind of freedom to even express any of her faith. But it was just her and I, and she knew I was going to the seminary, so she could say, well, you know, we believed in our heart, but that's all we could do. I felt really bad. That's all they could do. They couldn't bring it out into the public. Because they would have lost everything, their family, their job, their property, been in prison. It would have been terrible. Any place of persecution is the same way. I mean, the Christians who went into the catacombs, that's the place where they buried dead people under the city of Rome. I mean, there's not enough room for all these dead people after thousands of years in the same city, so they started digging holes in the ground to put people. They would go there in what is a graveyard, only underground, and they would have their worship services so that no one else who would want to go into that ugly, creepy place. That's where they were, could actually have real fellowship with each other. This is what it means in most parts of this world. And as, you know, ISIS and, you know, Boko Haram and everybody else is, you know, going crazy and killing Christians, it's making it more and more difficult to be a Christian publicly. Well, Daniel wasn't going to be a closet Christian. And you might say, well, why are you saying this word Christian? We're talking about the Old Testament here. What does Christ mean? The Anointed One. Christ the Anointed One is the same as Mashiach, Messiah. We are Messianic because Messianic and Christian is the same word. So I just want to say, before you get crazy, why is he saying Christian? Because he's looking forward to Messiah to come. That's why the window is open to the east. Because there's a Davidic covenant. And the one who's going to sit on that throne is going to rule forever. That's exactly what God promised. That's what he's looking forward to. He's also looking forward to the time when God is going to return the captives. He's 85 years old. It's been 70 years. It's just a matter of time. From the prophecy that came from Jeremiah. And I'm sure he would have read that prophecy from Jeremiah. I mean, it's just, I'm sure, just because everything that he and his men have done, you know, in Jeremiah 29, we read that a few chapters ago. So he is making supplications, he's kneeling on his knees, and he's praying and giving thanks. He's giving thanks. He's in a real tough spot and he's giving thanks. I mean, you could just as easily say, Lord, is this the way you treat your servants? All of a sudden, is it a matter of life and death to serve you? No, he's giving thanks. He knows exactly what he and all the rest of the Jews are deserving. Can you make him chop it? He prayed gave thanks. It says here he kneeled upon his knees. Kneeled upon his knees. Now, when you kneel on your knees, you're doing one thing, you're praying. You're not doing anything else. I just have to say that. I mean, sometimes it's hard to pray. The distractions that are going on, the stuff that's in our head, all the things of this world that are constantly yanking us away from being able to get our mindset to pray. Get on your knees. I mean, a lot of us, when we were kids, what do? We're on our knees and our hands are on the bed. We're on our knees on the floor and our hands are on the bed. I mean, some people grew up that way. That posture of prayer is what? I am in a place of humiliation before God. I'm not demanding of anything. I am asking. I am asking the God of the universe. I am asking my Heavenly Father. I am asking the one who I can trust, whom I'm dependent on. The posture really helps as our body is now in alignment. Even if our brain may not be, it really helps us in our heart. to humble our hearts before the Lord. He's not demanding anything. And this was his custom. This wasn't anything new. This is what he's always done. They watched him and they knew what he was going to do, and they knew his devotion to his God. And they knew he was going to do it. And sure enough, next day, after the thing was signed in the law, there he is. 3 times a day. Well, after the 3rd time, what do? They go and narc on him. They're going to go tell on him. Didn't you say, then you signed it, and that the law of the Medes and Persians can't change? Well, this Daniel, one of the captives of Judah. So now what are they bringing up? The fact that everybody knows that he was taken as a slave. It's quite interesting. How could everybody know that? Because he obviously looked like a slave. I have to really say that, because we can get these false ideas of Daniel. He probably always had some bond on him. It might have just been nothing more than an earring to prove to everyone that he was a slave. But he wasn't his own. He was owned by the state. He was taken as a piece of property no different than anything that was taken out of that temple and stuck in a treasury somewhere. These men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplication before his God. Then they came near and spake before the king concerning the king's decree. Hast thou not signed a decree that every man that shall ask a petition of any god or man within 30 days, save thee, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions? The king answered and said, The thing is true, according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, with ours was not. Then answered they and said before the king, That Daniel, which is of the children of the captivity of Judah, regardeth thee not, O king, nor the decree that thou hast signed, but maketh his petition 3 times a day. Then the king, when he had heard these words, was sore displeased with Daniel? No, was sore displeased with himself. He had already planned to put Daniel in charge of the whole place because he could trust him. This guy had all the expertise of years and years of years of administration of Babylon. What a perfect candidate for the job. Now he was displeased with himself, and set his heart on Daniel to deliver him, and he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver him. Well, how could he labor to deliver him? The law's been signed, you can't change it. But what could you do? You could go through all the law books, you could find anybody who is on your side to see if there is some other law that you could do that would supersede this law. You could strain your brain and have, you know, all kinds of sessions to figure out, okay, what kind of law can we put into place right now and have it signed by everybody that would supersede this one, that would keep him from having to get thrown into the lions? There was nothing. Sun went down. It's too late. Then these men assembled unto the king and said unto the king, Know, O king, that the law of the Medes and the Persians is that no decree nor statute which the king established may be changed. Then the king commanded, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. These guys who showed up are really putting it in Darius's face. The law can't be changed. The law can't be changed. We got you. They're really proud of the fact that they got rid of Daniel. And whenever it is that you're going to get into place and the folks who you're working with give you athlete scalp, they are very proud of the fact that they now have power over you. I've had that situation several times. I don't think there's any company I've worked for where I started making less money later after I started working there. This is the way it works in the world. The devil's got folks who he uses to make our lives a living hell, because we're not going to spend an eternity in hell. He is. So all he can do is ruin our life now. And they're very proud of themselves. They're very happy. And we can always see later that the folks who get our position are now having to deal with all the stuff we had to deal with, and now they get to see what it really feels like. And now they don't have the buffer zone. They're right there having to get all the abuse from our boss. I mean, it's like, okay, you can deal with the pressure now. I don't mind making less money. Life is a little bit easier for me now. Daniel's had this happen lots and lots of times. From being made in charge of the kingdom before of Babylon, and then who knows what happens during that period of time of 7 years or so before, you know, Nebuchadnezzar gets takes over and puts his son in charge. I mean, Daniel doesn't have his identity in the position that he's in. His identity is in serving his God and giving pleasure to his God and giving glory to his God. That's his identity. So the king had to command that they bring Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. Now the king spake and said unto Daniel, "Thy God, whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee." Now it sounds like, oh, he's a believer in Yahweh, Jehovah God. But the words here translated into English don't exactly say what the Aramaic is saying. It's basically, I think from Darius's point of view, he's saying, I did what I could do. Now the God that you serve continually, he's got to do something. He's got to deliver you, because I can't do anything. I think that's more of what he's saying. This God that you are serving, he's got to come through. I can't do anything. I think that's closer to what the Aramaic is saying here. Verse 17, and a stone was brought and laid upon the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet and with the signet of his lords, and that the purpose might not be changed concerning Daniel. Then the king went to his palace and passed the night fasting, neither were instruments of music brought before him, and sleep went from him. There's a couple of words in that verse that are hard to translate. Basically, he was refusing the table that was set before him. He was refusing the amusements that were given to him every night. So in other words, instead of going home in your lazy boy with your feet up and, you know, grabbing your TV dinner and you got the remote and you click on the TV, instead of everything being on, no, you're fasting. No sound, no music. I don't want none of this. And sleep went from him. No, he couldn't sleep that night. He probably was obsessing over the fact that these guys were able to do this trick right from under his eyes. And they were able to destroy this man who had all of the possibilities of running this whole country without dropping a beat. I mean, the best guy for the job, and he allowed this thing to be wrecked right in front of me? He fell for this? I mean, I'm sure he was eating himself alive, plus he was concerned for Daniel. Because at some point, when he realized how good Daniel was, that he could trust him, there must have been some relationship that was already started in this short period of time. Verse 19. Then the king arose very early in the morning, well, he was already awake anyway, and went in haste unto the den of lions. As soon as there was enough light to get going, he went over there. And when he came to the den, he cried with a lamentable voice unto Daniel. And the king spake and said to Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the living God, is thy God, whom thou servest continually, able to deliver thee from the lions? He is heartsick. He doesn't want to know what he's hoping isn't the case. He knows that Daniel is so devoted to his God, and he's heard the stories of how Daniel's God has come through in some miraculous ways. But Daniel's God isn't his God, so he can't trust the God of somebody else. There's a lot of old critics of the book of Daniel say, lion's den? Well, they didn't like the fact that there was a fiery furnace under Babylon. Much less are they willing to deal with a lion's den in in the Medo-Persian Empire. Well, they know from archaeology there was a fiery furnace. Lots of them. And historical accounts of people being thrown into them as execution. And they have found historical accounts of people being thrown to the lions. And they have actually, in Morocco, they have actually unearthed a lion's den from ancient times that would have, you know, BC, ancient times, you know, 500 BC, that it looks like they could have easily moved the lions from one part of this big underground cave to another part. So obviously they must have like thrown food for them to go over here so they could close that part off so they could clean up after the lions and then, you know, move them back, just like they do in zoos today. I mean, just because we got a zoo today, we think, oh, the old-fashioned folks, they never did any of this stuff, they wouldn't know how. No. People have been taking care of animals from the get-go. So yeah, they found these things. I just had to throw that in there. Verse 21. Then said Daniel unto the king, O king, live forever. I mean, you know, here he is in the lion's den, and I'm sure he's hearing the lion's tummies growling because they didn't get lunch. O king, live forever. I mean, this is a normal thing that you see through the book of Daniel a lot. O king, live forever. It is a respectful title. My God hath sent his angel and hath shut the lion's mouths. So there's more than one in there. He shut all their mouths. That they have not hurt me. For as much as before him, before my God, innocency was found in me. I have a just God. I mean, this is a theological statement from Daniel about his God. Innocency was found in me. And also before thee, O king, have I done no hurt. So Daniel is defending his own innocency of charges here. But he is also saying, before God, I am innocent. And because I am innocent, he is a just God. And he protected me from an unjust treatment. So he's talking about a God, his God who he trusts, who protected him because he was not guilty of any crime. And he says, and I'm not guilty of doing any crime against you, O king. Then was the king exceedingly glad for him. Oh, I'm sure glad you're not dead. I mean, that's about what he said. And commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no manner of hurt was found upon him because he believed in his God. Oh, well, maybe the lions weren't hungry that day. Well, you get to verse 24, and you get to see how the story ends. But the critics will say that. Well, okay, so he went into the den, and he came back out because the lions weren't hungry. They didn't want to eat him. Or something. I mean, it's ridiculous. They are looking for problems with the book of Daniel more than any other book of the Bible because Daniel so clearly prophesied about historical events that would happen in the future verbatim. And so they're constantly trying to figure out how can we discredit this book because it can't possibly be written ahead of time unless it's written by God. Well, if it's written by God, that means that they're going to be held account by a holy God for every thought, word, and deed. And they need Daniel to be discredited because they want a lie to hold on to because they don't want to be held accountable before their Creator. That's why every evolutionist is fighting against and every atheist is fighting against every Christian they see. If they really believe that there is no God, why should it bother them that somebody believes in it? If they really don't believe that there is a Creator to whom they must give an account, why should it matter if anybody believes? Because if you believe it, that means you're going to be held to an account by your Creator. That's just the next step in logic. So you can't allow that to happen. That's why they are so furious against anyone who believes in God. So what happened? Daniel disobeyed the law, and Daniel was punished. But the law didn't say he had to stay in there until he died. The law said he just had to be thrown in. Well, he got thrown in. And Darius, and whatever, you know, legal assistance he had, couldn't come up with some other way to pull him out before he got killed. Well, he got thrown in. That law got obeyed, because you can't break the law of the Medes and Persians. But we had this other thing that, you know, no, there's no way to get him out. So they took him out, and he wasn't dead, and no harm befell him. Well, the way these lion's dens are, it's a pit. Well, an 85-year-old man, you know, I would think that, you know, you fall down and you break a hip, you know, they threw him in. He must have landed on some soft lions. That's all I can say, you know. Because there was no harm found on him. Obviously, the angel who God had sent to close up the lion's mouth obviously protected his fall. Well, there is a verse in the Bible that says that. And that's what God did. He protected him. So this was just as miraculous as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in a fiery furnace, where they pull them out and they're closed and their hair isn't singed. They don't even smell like smoke. Amazing. This is amazing. Same God. He protects. Verse 24. Verse 24. The king has been up all night. You think he's in a good mood? Think Darius, at 62 years old, seeing these upstarts who are trying to destroy a very decent plan of running this kingdom? You think he's going to let them get away with it? The king commanded, and they brought those men which had accused Daniel, and they cast them into the lake, into the den of lions. Them, their children, their wives. We're talking zero tolerance here. I mean, this is kind of gross. But if you go into the book of Esther, what do we see? It wasn't just Mordecai. It was his kids. Mordecai didn't go to the gallows that was prepared for him. Haman went onto the gallows that was prepared for Mordecai. No, it was Haman and his boys. Everybody. They all died. Now we say gallows, but it's not like what we think, where it's this big thing and you put the noose around your neck. No, this is a place of impalement. That's what that was. I just have to say that. It's just as disgusting and gross and horrifying as being thrown into the lions. And the lions had the mastery of them and break all their bones in pieces, or ever they came in, they came at the bottom of the den. These folks who got thrown in, the lions were not just a little hungry, they were famished. There was an appetizer walking around all night long, giving praise to God, and their stomachs were growling, and God's angel wouldn't let them even open up their mouths. They couldn't even get close to him. And their mouths were watering. They were ready for lunch. So when some other folks came in without Yahweh's protection, their bones were broken by the lions before they even hit the bottom of this den of lions. It's pretty sad. They died instantly. Horrifying and scary, but they died instantly by the lions. Then King Darius wrote unto all the people, nations, languages that dwell in all the earth. Well, that seems kind of overstated. No. We're talking about a bigger empire than the Babylonian Empire. The Medes and Persians, much bigger. It actually went from all the way down into Africa, all the way out to India. This is a huge empire. So he sent this letter, and it's a decree. And the first thing is, peace be multiplied unto you. Well, this is the one who is in charge of your country, and he's telling you, may you just have peace be multiplied to you. It's kind of almost like Pax Romana. You got peace as long as you don't mess with Rome. This is going to be about the same. You've got peace as long as you don't mess with the Medes and the Persians. You don't mess with Cyrus and you'll have peace. Peace be multiplied unto you. I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom, men tremble and fear before the God of Daniel. Tremble and fear before the God of Daniel. Here we see Darius really taking Yahweh Jehovah God seriously. When you know that there is a God to whom you must answer, there is a fear and a trembling until you're in right relationship with Him. Absolutely. And even when you're in right relationship with Him, you are going to live in a fear of the Lord, which means every moment of your life you are taking it seriously before your holy God. That in every dominion of my kingdom, men tremble and fear before the God of Daniel, for He is the living God. This is a really amazing statement. Darius is saying, there is one living God. The rest of these things that people spend all this time on are dead. They can't help you because they're dead. This is really an amazing statement. The living God. It's not a dead idol. It's not wood and stone and silver and gold that Belteshazzar was worshiping. Or Belshazzar, not Belteshazzar. It's the living God. The living God. There isn't any other living God. For He is a living God and steadfast forever. This is His faithfulness. He is faithful forever. A living God who is faithful forever. That means you have a right relationship with Him. He is there forever. He's alive. He's alive with you all the time, and He is faithful to you all the time. And He saw this through the testimony of Daniel being willing to be thrown to the lions for doing something disobedient to the state because he refused to be disobedient to his God. And His kingdom, that which shall be not destroyed, and His dominion shall be even unto the end. Now, this is more information that Darius has that he could have only gotten from someone who knew the revelation of God. Well, Daniel had given the interpretation of Nebuchadnezzar's dream. What's the end of that dream? There was a rock that was hewn out without human hands that came, and what happened? It went and it destroyed all of those world empires, turned them into dust, and it blew away as chaff in the wind. And His kingdom will go on forever. Now this is a pretty amazing statement that comes from the king of the Medes and Persians. This is an amazing statement. This is a very strong profession of faith. After reading this, it's like, how could Darius not have a saving relationship with God here? Because he knows who the one true God is. He calls Him the living God. He says his kingdom will go on forever. This is amazing. He delivereth and rescueth. He worketh signs and wonders in heaven and in earth, who hath delivered Daniel from the power of the lions. So he believes in a God who is doing the miraculous. And he's seen it with his own eyes. He's seen the results with his own eyes. And he sees the results of the testimony of a man who is dedicated to serving Him through Daniel. Verse 28. So this Daniel prospered in the reign of Darius and in the reign of Cyrus the Persian. Now, for someone who says that, well, Darius is just Cyrus, why would this last part of this verse be here? Because they take it as an epexegetical vav, which means Darius specifically is Cyrus the Persian. But how could Darius the Mede be Cyrus the Persian? Well, because Cyrus the Persian has some Median blood in him. I just have to tell you that because you'll read it in really good commentaries, but I can't see that. I see it very clearly without trying to work in these, you know, semantical things with the epexegetical and in there. No. No, he was there prospering in the reign of Darius, and he was there prospering in the reign of Cyrus the Persian. Why would he say Cyrus the Persian as opposed to Darius the Mede? Because it's two different people. So anyway, that's my view. I'm sticking with it. Daniel prospered. Well, he prospered because of his testimony. He prospered because God showed himself faithful to Darius. He prospered in both of these reigns because they both saw a man of integrity. In Hebrews 11:33, Daniel is recognized as one who stopped the mouths of the lions. While he didn't do it with his brute strength, he was 85 years old, he did it because he believed and trusted in God. And God was faithful to send his angel to protect Daniel by closing the mouths of the lions. I just want to say just a couple of things about what Daniel and his lifestyle is showing us. In Psalm 101, there's a couple of things we can take out of there. I just want to do this real quick. Psalm 101. I will sing of the mercy and just judgment, which is justice unto thee, O Lord, I will sing. I will behave myself wisely in a perfect way. When wilt thou come unto me? I will walk within my house with a perfect heart. I will set no wicked thing before my eyes. I hate the work of them that turn aside. It shall not cleave to me. A froward heart shall depart from me. I will not know a wicked person. Whoso privily slandereth his neighbor, with him will I cut off. Him that hath an high look and a proud heart will I not suffer. Mine eyes shall be upon the faithful of the land, that they may dwell with me. He that walketh in a perfect way, he shall serve me. He that worketh deceit shall not dwell within my house. He that telleth lies shall not tarry in my sight. I will early destroy all the wicked of the land, that I may cut off all wicked doers from the city of the Lord. Now this is a psalm of David. But we see David, a man after God's own heart. But we say these same traits of integrity in this psalm for David's life as in Daniel's life. So in verse 1, I'll sing of the mercy and judgment and justice unto thee, O Lord, will I sing. I will behave myself wisely in a perfect way. He lives a blameless life before God and before men. I will walk within my house with a perfect heart. I will set no wicked thing before my eyes. Integrity keeps its eyes from evil. I hate the work of them that turn aside. It shall not cleave to me. Integrity protects itself from the perverse. A froward heart shall depart from me. I will not know a wicked person. Whoso privily slandereth his neighbor, him will I cut off. Him that hath an high look and a proud heart, I will not suffer. Integrity silences gossip and slander. Mine eyes shall look upon the faithful of the land, that they may dwell with me and walk in a perfect way. They shall serve me. Integrity seeks fellowship with God's faithful and wisdom from the wise. That was from verse 5. Verse verse 6 was, integrity denounces deceit and dishonesty. So verse 7, he that worketh deceit shall not dwell within my house, he that telleth lies shall not tarry in my sight. And then integrity confronts those who compromise. So in other words, he's holding people accountable for not living a life of integrity. I will early destroy all the wicked of the land, that I may cut off the wicked doers from the city of the Lord. So David is keeping sinners out of his city. Well, this is what a life of integrity does. We have to separate ourselves from folks who are worldly. It doesn't mean we don't witness to them. It doesn't mean that we aren't kind to them, but it means that we don't allow them to influence our lives. Verse 3 of Psalm 101, I will set no wicked thing before my eyes. That is what we have to practice doing. There's all kinds of wicked stuff. All you got to do is turn the stupid TV on. You can look at the stupid stuff and the ugly stuff. I mean, there's so much ugly stuff on the internet. As I am studying, and I do a search for anything that I'm studying, I don't care what it is in the Bible. There is something nasty. They have turned every single thing in the Bible and turned it into something nasty. Everything. I mean, you can't go very far without putting something disgusting and wicked before your eyes. So you turn away from it. David says they're going to make it a practice. Daniel obviously made it a practice to the point where folks like Belshazzar didn't want anything to do with him. Oh, I've heard of you. You're one of the captives of Judah. When you're living a life of integrity, I guarantee there's a lot of people who don't want to hang around with you. Because sinners love to hang around with sinners. They want other sinners to sin with them. And if you live a life of integrity, they know they're not going to get very far. What does a sinner want to do? They want company sinning. If it's, they want an ear to hear all the nasty stuff you got to say. They want somebody to laugh at their nasty jokes. They want somebody to hear the gossip they just heard. If a man of integrity doesn't suffer them, doesn't allow it. Well, this is what Daniel was like. So I just want to bring that up a little bit. He was also a faithful man. And in 1 Corinthians 4, starting with verse 1, let a man so account of us as ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. But with me it is a very small thing that I should be judged of you or of man's judgment. Yea, I judge not my own self, for I know nothing by myself, yet am I not hereby justified, but he that judges me is the Lord. Therefore judge nothing before the time until the Lord come, who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsels of the hearts, and then shall every man have praise of God. This is the way Daniel lived his life. A minister must be found, a steward must be found faithful. Well, Daniel didn't own anything. He was owned by Babylon. Why did he get this high position? Because he was a good steward. It's no different than us. We think, well, I worked hard for this, and I'm deserving of this promotion, and I'm deserving of this title, and I'm deserving of this pay raise. But that's not how it is in God's economy. God's the one who gives all things to us for us to enjoy. But is it for our enjoyment? We are stewards. All the stuff that he gives us, it still belongs to him. How do we use all this stuff to give him pleasure, to give him glory. We can continue to think about how I can get more, how I can have more money so that I don't have to worry about stuff and I can just buy whatever I want. Of course, James tells us you don't have because you don't ask. And you don't have because when you ask for the wrong motives, you can spend it on your own desires. So God isn't going to just waste on us when we're just going to foolishly spend it for our own desires. And I got lots of them, but because we're cutting it short, I want to see what Jesus said in Luke 16. Because there's a lot of them in Proverbs. In Luke 16, verse 10, "He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much, and he that is unjust in least is also unjust in much." Well, here is a man of integrity, Daniel. And he was faithful in the least. Well, what was the least? The food that he was going to put in his mouth. He had integrity before God that he would not become ceremonially unclean by eating something that would have been offered up to an idol. Something that would have been a sin before God. And you could say, oh, well, that's just kosher. Oh, well, that was just ceremonial law. It wasn't moral law. There is no difference between civil, ceremonial, and moral in the Old Testament. It's all moral because you're under God. We understand moral law in the New Testament because we can see what God loves and what God hates. So we can understand living a life under the New Covenant where we are doing things out of love, because love does what? Love fulfills the law. It fulfills the law, the first table of the law, which is loving God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. And it fulfills the second table of the law, which deals with our fellow man in love does no harm to its neighbor. Love loves others more than himself. Love wants to do things the way to others the way they would have people do things to them. Another thing about Daniel was a spirit was found in him. It was quite interesting the way he said it. I have my Daniel open here. Because an excellent spirit was in him. That's why Darius preferred him above everybody else. And he wanted to set him to be king over the whole region, the whole realm. Because an excellent spirit was in him. Well, we can go to Galatians and see what that is. Galatians 5. You know where I'm going. But I have to read it anyway. Galatians 5. Verse 22. "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are in Christ have crucified the flesh with the afflictions and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit." In verse 22, it says the fruit of the Spirit is love. We talked about love. Joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness. And that next word is faith. But it's basically what we would understand as faithfulness or trustworthiness. A steward is to be found faithful. That is a gift of the Holy Spirit. When we are walking in the Spirit, walking in the Holy Spirit, it's not all about the special signs and wonders. What's the greatest amazing special sign and wonder that there is? Love. Loving people, and this is agape love. This is self-sacrificial love. The Holy Spirit empowering someone to love those people who are difficult, to love those people who are prickly, to love those people who don't respond to them, who do bad things to them when you're kind to them. Agape love is loving the unlovable, loving the unlovely. That's what agape love is. But at the end of that verse, it's also faithfulness. That's the fruit of the Spirit. Darius had never met a man like Daniel in his life before. Well, it takes the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, to be able to give you the wisdom to interpret a dream. But it wasn't just that one slight little manifestation of the Holy Spirit that was in Daniel. It was the Holy Spirit in all of his fullness. And the first thing that Darius met when he met Daniel was the Holy Spirit in all the fruits of the Spirit. Now, when you meet a Spirit-filled believer, you are coming into contact with everything that Jesus was like. Jesus wasn't grumpy. When Jesus got angry, it was a righteous anger. Jesus wasn't touchy. Jesus didn't make people walk on eggshells. Jesus was always kind. Jesus was always forgiving. Jesus was always giving sacrificially. This is what Jesus was, because he was filled with the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit was upon him. When we meet a Spirit-filled believer, we are going to meet somebody who is so overflowing with Jesus, it just spills out on everybody they come into contact. That's what it means to be filled. When, I got a glass here. You want to be filled? Well, what happens with the glass? Well, I can go around, I can carry this as I'm moving the furniture around as we're getting ready for the tables because, we're getting hungry and all that. But what's going to happen? Well, we're all working together to try to accomplish this next task in the church. And what's going to happen? I'm going to get bumped into. Well, what happens to this? They're going to spill out. If it's all filled with me and my identity and who I think I am and what my title is and how high my education was and how much money I make and how many people I tell what to do in my life, and that's going to spill out on you and it's going to be ugly. But if I'm filled with the Holy Spirit and it dumps out, I'm going to be dumping Jesus out on whoever bumps into me. That's what it means to be filled with the Spirit. This is what Daniel was like. There wasn't anybody who Darius ever met who was anything like him. And he was a man of integrity. The only thing that anybody could get on him was the fact that he was devoted to his God. And Daniel was looking forward to those three times a day when it was just him and God. In his little upper chamber somewhere, all by himself, he could just commune with his God. And three times a day was his practice. And I don't know how he scheduled his day, but that was the first thing on his schedule. And if you had to work with a Daniel, you had to work his schedule. I can only work till 10:30. I'm sorry. At 10:30, I've got a previous engagement. I've kept this engagement for 85 years. There's nothing going to get in the way of me keeping my time with my Lord. That's what a man of integrity does. Now, there was a friend of mine who wanted to try to do this himself, and he put a little alarm on his phone, and it would kind of go off, and because he wanted to make a practice that when I would go off, he would pray. That's not planning your life ahead. It ended up being a ritual, and then he had to quit. Okay, I got to do this real quick. He put himself under a ritual. Well, as we are getting more mature in the Lord, are we getting closer to Him? Or are we getting more religious? I mean, the trend of even the evangelical church is to become more and more religious. They got more and more religious things to do and more religious type stuff. It's all about this experience of being religious. Daniel was a man who had a real relationship with his Creator. And it showed. Was he religious? 3 times a day he went to pray. But it wasn't because he was afraid and that alarm went off and I better keep my promise. No, he loved his Lord. He proved it his entire life. And now that he's an old man, this is just his custom. So we can learn a lot from Daniel's life. And now in the next chapter, Daniel gets a lot more difficult. This is the easy part. We're actually going to backtrack because the next chapter is going to be during the reign of Belshazzar. So it's no longer chronological. But now what goes on is some of the visions that God had given Daniel. Why? Well, how can I get a vision from God? I want to be like a special person like this too. How did he get visions from God? Well, he obviously had the book of Jeremiah. He was reading God's Word. He was eating up God's Word, whatever he had of God's Word, and I'm sure he kept it all in his mind. But he also spent time with the Lord. That's what he did. You want visions from God? You want to take a step further? Make an appointment with God. Keep your appointments with God. The more time you spend with Him, the better it's going to be. I know we're over, but I just have to go to Psalm 24. Psalm 24? Let's see. That's a different one. That's 25. It's 26. I'm sorry. Okay. Okay. No, I was right. It was 25. All right. Verse 12. What man is he that feareth the Lord? Him shall he teach the way that he shall choose. When we fear the Lord, that means that we are being obedient to the truth that we know. That means that we are taking God seriously. Verse 13. His soul shall dwell at ease, and his seed shall inherit the earth. So you're not worried about stuff, because you fear the Lord. You're trusting God. You're taking God seriously. Verse 14. The secret of the Lord is with them that fear Him, and He will show them His covenant. The secret of the Lord is with them that fear Him. The word secret here is close to the word that could be translated couch or sofa. The idea is, if you're sitting with somebody on the couch, you're having an intimate conversation. How could Daniel get all these visions? How could he be given the ability to understand dreams? Because he is spending the time. He's spending the time with the Lord. The secret of the Lord is with them that fear Him, and He will show them His covenant. I want to hear from the Lord. Well, you have to take time with Him. There wasn't any music going on. There wasn't any dancing girls. There wasn't a big table provided like for Darius up in Daniel's upper room where he opened up the window towards Jerusalem. It was just him and God. So I just have to say, this isn't just Old Testament. I'm not saying, oh, we're going to get a revelation totally different from what the Bible says. No, you take everything. What does it say in 1 Thessalonians? Do not despise prophecies, but what? Test all things. Because all kinds of stuff can talk to us in the silence. So if you get it, you better test all things. So if somebody's going to come up in church and say, you know, I've got a prophecy, well then all those who are assembled to hear the word of prophecy have to make a judgment. Because anybody can come up with anything that sounds like, because I don't care, if God has ever made any time with you, and you know you've heard His voice, and you know how He felt when He talked to you, the devil can counterfeit that to the T. So you have to test everything. Well, how do you test it? What did God already say? Well, if we aren't faithful to know what He already said, how do we know with whatever we hear that it's Him or not? Well, Daniel did. So when we go on to these next chapters, it's going to get a lot more difficult. And I'm going to have to tell you a few places where I don't understand. But we're going to teach through Daniel. And some things it takes longer for people to understand. And some of these prophecies we are not going to understand until we get there. And we'll see it very clearly. Wow, verbatim! But none of us were given the ability to figure it out. Sometimes God puts pieces together. And I see that happening as a lot of things that were written that are prophetic. We can see how some of the puzzle pieces put together. And we see the book of Revelation quoting from Daniel a lot. And what does the book of Revelation do? He takes the puzzle pieces of Daniel and locks them together so we can see how it works out. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank You for this amazing person that a couple other of Your holy writers made mention of and showed how righteous they were before You, before the people. Lord, thank You for giving us this beautiful example of a man who had a life of integrity before You and before men, a man who didn't love his life to the death, but he wanted to serve You and give You pleasure with every part of his life. Lord, help us be Daniels, not just when it comes to that place of civil disobedience when necessary, but that everyday devotion to You, dear God. We ask You help us, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.